Welcome to a special edition of Crawford County Outdoors. I'm Duane Kohler, and we are joined by John Crooks. John, welcome back. It's been a while
since
we talked, but noted here, sports writer in Crawford County, and we never talked before about your bears here. So tell some stories here.
Well, we've got bears. I've got this bear here is actually a black bear, as is the bear rug. These are...
Well, they're not very black, though. They're, well, they're almost blonde.
They're almost blonde. That's what they call them, a cinnamon bear.
Okay.
Or a blonde bear, but they are actually classified black bears, as I understand it. I shot this bear probably sometime in the mid-90s in Manitoba, Canada.
Okay.
Hunting over baits, had a 7mm mag. I saw baits or bear hourly. Every hour there was like six or eight different bears coming in. And I had told the guy that I was after a cinnamon bear, so he advised that particular bait. And first night in, why I shot this guy. Not overly big, I think the guy fairly was about 250 pounds, so. And this bear rug, I shot him in western Montana, actually on an elk hunt. I had a bear tag that year, and we went back to spike camp one night, and our tent was pretty much gone. Little two-man tent was down, and our food, we had a lot of canned goods and, of course, donuts.
Donuts.
And as far as you could see was donut wrappers. And so we, at first we figured it was a grizzly bear. So we managed to get the tent set back up and get some remnants of, you know, we weren't so scared of the bear. But next morning, right at daybreak, we were packing our bags, getting ready to go elk hunting. And I looked up and here come this bear down through the woods and picked up over a log and...
Looking for donuts,
but he found no more than donuts. So anyway, that's a pretty good story there. And this,
I see a black bear over in the corner there.
Yeah, a black bear. He came from Ontario, northern Ontario. A little story behind that bear. I'd been with an outfitter for a week, and hadn't seen a bear all week, and I was kind of grouchy and complaining. And so the one afternoon, the wife and I said, we're going into the little town for an hour or so, and we stopped at a McDonald's and had a bunch of hamburgers, and I bought a hamburger or two and I wrapped it up, and she said, what's that for? I said, that's to put on the bear bait. So that evening I put one or two hamburgers on the bait, I don't remember. And that night, why, this bear come up through the woods with his nose in the air.
How about that?
Boom, and I shot him.
So someone that says that McDonald's is bad for you, bad for the bear anyway.
Yeah, the bear loved him.
The
bear
loved you.
Yeah.
How about that?
So, interesting story.
Well, so we're going to talk deer hunting today.
Yes.
We came out before and we covered a lot of ground, but there's more things. There's new things that are coming along.
Right.
I've been hearing a lot about decoys, and I'm hearing about scents and whatever, so I'm hoping you can show us some things you do with those things.
Right. With rifle season just around the corner, well, I've got a lot of things to show you out there. I've got a lot of scrapes, a lot of big rubs, some of my deer shanties, and some of the things I do that works. If I do something and it don't work, I don't do it. But these things work, so we'll get out and take a walk and we'll see what we can show you.
Well, before we go outside, let's take a look at some of your trophies. We haven't seen, I think you got some newer ones.
Sure,
since we were here
I got some new ones. I've got a couple pretty nice deer heads since you were here last. So.
Very good.
Thank you for showing. Okay, let's do it.
So John, your trophies on the wall are pretty impressive. I see a couple new ones from when we were here the last time.
Right.
One dark one with his head kind of down there.
Yeah, and that's kind of a good thing when you get a new one. Why?
Now, was his head down and was his ears back in the when you shot him?
Yeah, he was in the sneak position.
So that's a sneak. That's a sneak.
Yeah.
So he had him posed in his mount the way that he was.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
He had come in and he just worked his scrape and he was sort of looking my way and I thought, oh boy, I better do something here quick.
Okay.
So yeah, I got him last archery season.
Now, what about Zeus? Isn't that what he was called?
Yeah, I call that buck Zeus. I hunted him in archery season. Never saw him. That seems to be standard. And I shot him the second week of rifle season. Again, that was one of the bucks that was running a doe.
Okay.
His neck was straight out. He could care less that it was rifle season. He was after that doe, period.
Interesting.
He ran by me about 40 yards. I had my grunt call out. I could see he was moving. And I grunted real loud, and of course he just come to a halt. When he come to a halt, why I drop the thing and boom, and that was it.
Well, when we get out touring around, I want to ask you some more about how you approach it different times of the season. But let's first talk about it. Let's say I get one, and maybe it's not the most perfect antler, or maybe I find antlers on the ground or whatever. Are there other things? Now, you've got some, looks like a hobby here. You've doing some things with some of the antlers.
Exactly. This is what I call my rainy day worker, these cold, snowy days that I can't be out tracking deer or whatever. But I go out in the spring, and I pick up shed antlers. You can see that one's shed there by the pedicles, the way it broke off.
Okay.
Now you can see a mouse or a squirrel has found this one before.
Nibbled on the ends there a little
bit. Yeah, nibbled on the ends, but that gives it character.
Okay.
But I do, I pick up a lot of antlers in the spring. I run a lot of different squares, and of course you can cut them with a hacksaw. And what I've started to do the last few years is make knives. And Duane, that's probably one of my favorite knives is the antler. The antler knives.
Now, how'd you get it attached to the antler?
It's not that difficult, really. What I do is I drill a hole, and the hardest part is I put the antler in the vise, and drill the hole has to be perfectly centered.
Okay.
And I put the shank of the knife, which is only maybe a half inch, and I usually actually grind that down smaller, and very carefully fit it in. And I have a super glue, it's like a two-part epoxy.
Sure.
I mix the glue with the hardener, put it in the vise, make sure it's centered, pour it in, and that'll harden up in maybe 15 minutes.
Okay.
Then the next day, well, you can start sanding anything that comes over. Makes a very nice knife. You can see in the back here, I hunt a lot with a 257 Roberts. So I have a shell casing in the end. So there's just, you can do most anything with these knives. Now here's one with a smaller blade that I left the brow tine on.
A little character in that one,
yeah,
sure.
That's how about that? A little character. And so you have to sort of examine your horn and see what you want to do.
That's pretty neat. Now that's good for a lefty.
Yeah, well, I'm a lefty.
And that would work. That would work sort of, but not as well as it would for a left-hander.
Right.
How about that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's really nice. That's really nice work.
Right.
What about the leather there? I see you got some holsters.
Yeah, I got into leather work. The first time I built a knife, I took it down to the Amish guy, the harness maker, and he made me a sheath. And of course, I watched how he did everything, and so it didn't take me long to figure out how to make the sheath myself. On a lot of them, I glue them, I lace them. This one here, I have two holes for cartridges. You can put a couple extra shells in there. And I'll show you this one here quickly. I just draw up my own patterns, just whatever. You know, I do a lot of basket weave. You can see there's basket weave. There's a picture of a buck. This knife here, I put a walnut handle on it. Pick the blades, and you can see there's three brass pins in there that you drill. It's just slow, tedious work, but it's just busy work on a rainy day.
Now, how'd you get what kind of finish is that on there?
I use Birchwood Casey gunstock finish.
Okay.
It dries real hard, it's waterproof, and it makes a really nice, bright handle.
So now, how do you get the pattern? How do you get the pattern from in your head onto the leather, and then get it cut and all that kind of stuff?
Okay, well, I actually do design them, and the way I do is I make the sheath first out of paper.
Make it out of paper. Okay.
Make it out of paper.
Okay.
I actually, now this paper right here is actually the sheath for this double knife. I just made this one here a month ago. You can see there, I've got a nice buck in it. I've got the basket weave. But this was made first on the paper. Otherwise, if I cut the expensive leather and cut it wrong,
then
I got a mess.
Out of luck.
But I made it out of paper, and then and these are a couple dandies too. These are a little different. I get most of my blades online through an outfit called Smoky Mountain. These two blades, actually, I got on eBay. But that's kind of nice.
Yeah,
that should
right.
work for a right-hander,
okay.
I would think.
All right.
Well, you would know I'm a lefty.
There we go. I like that shape of blade, too, for getting the skin off the deer.
Yeah,
for,
good skinner.
That rounded kind of, not real long and real pointy, but more rounded for kind of, that
right.
more of a scraping, really, than a cutting so much. Yeah. How about that? That looked like that worked pretty well for that job.
Yeah, and again, they're both pinned. You know, they have the pins in them, so that nothing's going to come off. That glue dries like concrete. But that's just an idea of some of the things they do.
Very nice.
Here's something a little different. I put a knife in with a flashlight. When I bow hunt, why I'm always losing my light, or it's falling out of the pack, or I can't find it, which pocket. Now it's on my belt. I've always got a knife to gut the deer, and I've got a light right there handy.
There you go.
So it kind of works. Black leather looks good with a black handled knife. That would be good for small game.
Sure,
birds,
sure.
Rabbits. Smoky Mountain has just hundreds and hundreds of different blades.
Now, can you shape them a little bit with your grinder if you want a different shape to them?
Yeah, you can, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. But that gives you an idea of what you can do. Here's one here that's made out of, I believe I told you it was corral or something that you use on the kitchen cabinet. I went to a place where they made those, and he gave me some odds and ends of scrap.
And you could just shape that with a sander?
The electric sander,
okay.
This sander, yeah. Just sand them all off, drill it, pin it, glue it, and last forever.
That's pretty unique. How about that?
Yeah. So what else have we got here? Small ones. Here's something a little bit smaller that I do. This one here was made out of walnut and oak. Now I like that one. That's nice for skinning, like pulling the hide off.
Sure, sure.
Really nice. You can just take it and break
the hide. Those pulling the hide jobs, you would think, you know, those that had never done that, you would think that would be a cutting, but it's really, it's more pulling and
it's
then just
more
a little,
pulling and
just
you're
a little shaving
the fat.
And pulling and shaving. Yeah,
you
yeah.
Just keep pulling, yeah.
Again, that's something unique. That I like that curved shape for that sort of project.
Yeah.
So how about that?
So I like knives, and I've got all different sizes. What do we got up here? We've got a holster here I made for a handgun. So that's pretty much what this guy does on a rainy day.
So one thing you got to have is tools when you're going to be deer hunting, right? And when
exactly.
You're going to be big game hunting. So,
exactly. It's all about the tools.
So let's go and take a look, and maybe you can show us some things that are new and some things that folks would be, they'd find as helpful tips.
Sounds great. We've got a nice sunny day here. We'll take a walk and we'll show you some buck rubs and some scrapes, and we'll see what we can get into out there.
Very good. So, John, we're talking tools here. Here's one pretty interesting tool here. I'm not sure that, is that going to help in hunting season this
year? Well, it may. It may. If things really go bad here the first day, well, I can always resort to that if I have to finish the buck off.
Well, what about some other tools? I see you got some things in your pouch there.
Yeah, I carry a lot of goodies with me, Duane, and this here is one of the things I used a lot for archery and of course, for rifle season, too, my range finder.
Okay.
And, you know, I like to know how far, especially with a crossbow.
Now, that doesn't, and I'm learning myself, that doesn't make a big difference.
You betcha.
The first time I shot it, when I missed it, because it ran a little bit, and I'm thinking, okay, it's 20 yards. I never even thought about it, and it ran another 20 yards
right
underneath. You
right.
Know.
Yep, I've done that. I've done that on elk. I've done it on everything. So finally, I broke down and bought one of these. And if you have time to use it, but what I normally do, when I'm in this stand, I'll range like that big rock or that big tree, that stump, and then I put it away where I can get it in a hurry. And I find that way when the buck comes out, he walks by that rock.
He's in front of that rock, you know it's 25 yards or whatever.
I know he's 25 or 50.
Okay.
But that's kind of a must for, I think, any hunter. And I always carry a little saw of some type. Seems like there's always a limb or a brush in the way.
Right in the way.
Yeah, always in the way. And again, I own my own property, so I'm trimming on my own land.
You're not damaging someone's tree without their permission. Right.
I won't have a landowner after me. Grunt call, I use this a lot, even in rifle season, it stops him. You get a buck out there and he's running away. This will stop him.
Now, what are you saying to him with that? What's the message, you know, that he's picking up there when he hears that?
What I'm saying is, hey, I'm over here. And I'm bigger than you. I try to sound aggressive, and
so it's a challenge. I mean, it's a
challenge. Yeah.
Okay.
In fact, I used it just last week on a really a big buck I saw back here. He disappeared on me once. I got this call out, grunted. He come out totally enraged. His ears were laid back, and unfortunately, he didn't seem to know where I was, and he took off running the other way. But it got his attention. So.
So now we're right at the time, give or so. You probably let me ask you that question generally. The time of the year, the time of the season, or whatever. I may be totally wrong on this, but early on, maybe you want to be more oriented towards the food.
Food plots.
Mid archery, a little later in archery season, it comes to be breeding season. That's a challenge. Hey, there's another deer getting in there after the girls. I want to get after.
Exactly.
And then later on, you back to the food again. Maybe in the rifle season.
Yeah, maybe post rut. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Right now it's prime time, this last week. The buck should be chasing does more than they are. I'm out there every morning and afternoon, but I'm seeing some chasing, but now's the time to get out this. The rattling horns are hanging back on my stand. I use them quite a bit.
I've read that even the those that don't get bred during the normal, Halloween to, first couple weeks of November, they come around again, maybe right at the start of rifle season. So you still may be helpful
Absolutely.
To have that approach, right?
And that is an excellent, excellent point, because I've shot a lot of the big bucks on that wall with a rifle in rifle season, especially that second week. I mean, they're still chasing does. The woods have quieted down. And if the doe's there, he's going to chase her. And I've shot several with that, and I try to stop them. In fact, the one you haven't seen on my wall, Wyatt, it was shot right down here chasing a doe.
Okay.
Big 9-point.
Now I see you brought some scent here. Talk about that if you would.
Yeah, doe urine. This time of year, I'm starting to switch over to the doe and heat urine, estrus urine, but this works good. Urine's urine. I use it on the scrapes. And once we get in the back, we're gonna work the scrape, and I'm gonna put this felt pad on the scrape.
Put the scent on the pad and
yep.
then leave the pad there?
Yep, leave
now,
the pad there.
That doesn't scare them away, that doesn't scare them, or?
No, they could care less. What they'll do, the bucks will wind check the scrape coming in, usually on the east side of the scrape, they'll wind check it, pick up that smell. And this, especially this week, and even the rest of the month, they can't resist. They're going to usually go in and see what's going on.
So I've been talking to a person who's new to hunting in Pennsylvania. It's like, now how come that's not considered a baiting or whatever?
Right.
But scenting is okay by Pennsylvania rules, but you can't put out food.
Right. No food. You can hunt natural food, like I can hunt the edges of my cornfield or where the acorns are, but no.
But you're not bringing out. You're not bringing out a wheelbarrow full of corn and pouring it.
Exactly. Yeah,
that's a whole different thing.
Right.
But the scenting is okay.
Exactly. So I use a lot of it, and seems to work.
Let's talk about the seasons again. So early on, what would I use scent wise, and then in the breeding season, and then later on, would there be a change?
I would say the doe urine, just a plain doe urine, is good to use any time. That and the buck urine early is good. It's an attractant. The scrapes again, they're like the old fire hydrants. But I tend to go more to the doe and heat urines for like this week.
Okay.
In fact, I think I've used it all up last week, so I'll be using this back here today. But it works, especially at night. Of course, I see the pictures. I'm getting pictures of big bucks every night back here. And they're just kind of going nocturnal on me, so.
Is there any magic in, you're coming out of the night now. Any little magic trick you can pull to get them out there in daytime so you can get a shot at them?
When I figure that out, I'll tell you.
Okay. Everybody wonders that one, I guess.
Yeah,
okay.
This year has been unusual. I guess that's about it for the bag right now. Again, you need a drag. You always have a drag rope with you, so I throw that in my bag, and that's pretty much my bag of goodies.
Yeah, trying to drag one without having something to tie its feet together, everything's getting caught on everything.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's
and what
no
I've
fun.
Learned to do in my older age now, I just call the wife on the cell phone and say, hey, bring the ATV back.
Bring a machine, okay.
Yeah, that or the tractor in the bucket, because, but that's just there in case I do need it, so.
Hey, change the subject for a second. When we were here before, you were just kind of getting off the ground with your Indian village. Tell us about this a little bit. It's grown.
As you can see, it's expanded. I like making Indian teepees. It's quite evident. I've got six of them here now. And the wife will laugh, say, what are you doing? I say, well, I'm going to put up another teepee today. So I have a lot of fun doing it. I cut the poles. I can probably build one in a couple days, even myself. And if I can get someone to help, well, that's all the better. But it takes about 8 or 10 good, strong poles timed together. And I just start throwing tarps on them. These aren't canvas, but they're heavy-duty white tarps. And these tarps will probably last 5-6 years.
So is this attracted deer?
You know, actually I could. I could sit out here any evening and the does are all around here eating.
There you go.
Then they go in the corn, but I'm back a little further, but I know I could sit in there and look out and at least see them. So
you get you see the fancy camo ones at the sporting goods store with all kinds of, you know, special windows, whatever. Hey, this might be a good way to come up with a ground stand.
Yeah,
huh?
And I've got a blind. I don't have it up right at the moment. It's in the garage.
But what do you think of ground hunting versus, you know, in an elevated stand? What's your thoughts about that?
They both work great. I tend to get in a tree most of the time. Certain places there are no trees, maybe field edges, cornfield edges, and that's when I. Doesn't take me but, you know, 10 minutes to get back, get the blind and throw it up and I'm in it. So the blinds are great, the right stand, the right day, you know.
It's all about being at the right spot, huh?
Exactly, you bet. Yep.
I know when we were here the last time, we talked about, you know, kind of keeping an eye out for where the deer are traveling. And mm-hmm. So I took your advice and I was able to, I got my first archery deer this year.
Right.
And I took your advice. I was, they're, for whatever reason, they're coming through this little neck area and mm-hmm. they're in between two patches of woods. And so I set up shop and I saw them going past and finally got one in range and got one for the freezer. So,
yep. Great.
So let me ask you about goals for your hunting trip. So
yep.
At that point, my goal was to get one in the freezer, not necessarily mm-hmm. to get the biggest trophy or whatever. If my goal was different, I would probably need to approach that differently, or would I?
Yeah, probably. As I get older, I tend to pass up 99% of the bucks I see. I'm usually hunting one or two bucks every year.
A particular one that you've seen on your trail camera. Okay.
I give a buck a name, and I stay with him until I get him. So, of course, a lot of years you go without deer meat, too.
Well, that's why I was wanting to get one in the freezer, because I got skunk last year, so I really want to get one in the freezer. We have all our favorite recipes, and you got to make you know your favorite things. And
sure.
So, wanted to get one in the freezer. So hopefully a big buck will come along at some point. So.
Sure. Good.
Well, I know you got some other things you want to show us. How about if we take a walk?
Let's do it. Okay.
Now, John, we got something we talked about the last time, but see a little advancement here. I think I remember this decoy from the last time we visited. So she's got a friend here, huh?
Right. Of course, you met Maybelle. I call her Maybelle, and I use her a lot for my archery season.
So if there's a scent or whatever that smells like a female, oh, I see one over there.
Okay. Or when I rattle,
okay.
They come in, and oh, there you are, and it really draws them in. In fact, I had a nice 7-point in last week to within 10 yards of me, maybe 15 yards from her, but he was totally fixed on her, never once looked. Of course, he was legal, but I left him walk because he wasn't the deer I was after.
Okay. Did they notice the fact that they're standing frozen still and not, you know, does that seem to...
They don't seem to care, especially these last 2 weeks of archery season. They are so fixated on finding a doe that they're... You know, you see them running, they're running in the woods, their necks are straight out, and they're looking for these does, they're trailing does, and all of a sudden they just doe, you know, okay. And they have to come in, at least check it out. A lot of them will walk around it, smell it, and just, okay, and then they leave.
I'm seeing, like, you know, you can see where the head attached, where the limbs attach, and so on, and it's like, you know, that's like what draws my eye, you know,
right.
But I guess if you're looking, if your mind's on something else,
yeah.
If you're a deer or you're a doe, there's a doe.
Yeah, yep.
You're, okay.
I guess the thing is, if they're remotely in doubt, why they check it out, but in that process, why I've got them with the bow, if I want
as
that
they're
buck.
Exploring around,
yeah,
there, okay.
They do their job.
Now,
this
what happens
year,
when you get a male, you know, a male decoy in the mix there?
Right. This guy, so far, I've had in the house. I'm afraid to put him out. He's so big. He's beautiful. He's big. He looks like a pony. But I just don't know how these bucks are going to react. I might get him out this week just to try him out. But you know, the look at him, he looks like he weighs 300 pounds. You know,
and so that's the challenge. I mean, that's the rattling,
yeah.
You know, or that's
yeah,
the grunting that,
yeah.
or whatever, and
the
you
grunt.
Know.
And I am hunting big bucks, so I should get him out here, maybe even yet tomorrow, and see what happens.
Okay.
I guess worst case scenario, why I spook the buck I'm after. So,
okay.
But with that, why we're going to try him, and again, I do not recommend decoys for rifle season.
Sure.
They're obviously for, you know, they're dangerous. Somebody comes along and sees her and has a doe tag, why, who, you know what's going to happen? The same with this guy.
and you're going to probably be fairly close by. So
sure, I'm going to be close, either in a ground blind or most likely up in a tree. People do use them for rifle season. As far as I know, it's legal, but it is without a doubt dangerous. So.
Now, even some of the archery target deers that you know, they're pretty realistic looking. You know, would any of those work as a decoy?
I've used those. Sure, I have two of them up there, and sometimes if I want to create something like on the food plot, maybe I'll put these two out and maybe those two.
Okay.
And deer going by, they're gonna check them out. So.
Interesting.
Yeah, lots of ideas.
Something else to try for down the road.
Yeah, and what I do on Maybell sometimes is I'll take a paper towel and I'll duct tape it on her back hand and put a few drops of the doe urine.
Okay.
You've got the smell, now you've got the motion on a windy day.
Sure.
That paper towel works, and that works real good. So, a few things about decoys.
Interesting.
Yep.
Well, we've got some more things to see.
Sure, lots to see up ahead. Let's go do it, huh?
So John, rifle season's coming up, so you got to get your gun out and practice, get sighted in a little bit. Tell us about this.
Okay, something I came up with when I shoot, and I do shoot a lot, as you can see by the front of this, I like to catch my bullets. I don't like the bullets going through the woods or hitting somebody, or, you know, I know what when I shoot, my bullets are safe. But what I did is I built a box out of plywood. It's 3 foot by 3 foot by 2 foot deep.
Okay.
And the lid comes off, and I fill that with sand. And
okay.
It's filled with compressed packed sand. Put the lid on it, compress it again. And I can shoot for years now in that box. And if the front ever does shoot out, why, I just put a new piece of plywood right over it.
Sure.
Naturally, before it breaks. And it works. I like it.
So you don't have any... nothing's flying anywhere. Everything is totally contained. You don't have
exactly,
any
exactly. Yeah, no sand flies out. Seems like the wood compresses somewhat. You know, okay. And the sand just doesn't come out. Now, where it gets to the place where it does, well, then it's time for a new 3 foot by 3 foot piece of plywood and screw it right over this.
So sighting in, I mean, you want to know where your bolt's going to hit. You want to
sure.
And now do you adjust different ranges and at this target, so you're good at, you know, 50 yards, 100 yards, 150 yards.
Right. Well, it's just a matter. I bring down a little table, or I shoot off these picnic tables. I move them. I have smaller tables, portable bench rests, 50 yards, 100 yards, 200, 300. I can get out on that knoll and probably shoot 300 yards.
Okay.
And again, my bullet's going in that box, and. Of course, I've got my range finder. I check each position with a range finder. Click, click. Tune them right in. It's good
so,
for the so handgun.
You know how to adjust whenever it comes to seeing that deer in the scope.
Yes,
if
exactly.
It's 100 yards or if it's 200 yards, that makes a difference.
Right.
About how you're
going to
aim.
Big time, yeah. Trajectory, sure.
I know you like to shoot handguns too, and I see you've got some targets set up there down below the building we saw last time we were here. So that's a pretty
right.
good practice, I bet.
That's something new too. That's a lot of fun. That's the first time I ever got into steel. And what I like about the steel, of course, you've got the gong, the noise.
So you know if you hit it or not.
You know
you
if
that
you hit
clank,
it.
Yeah.
And then it swings. So it's a pretty, you know, different. It's an alternative to this. And so at some point I'll probably expand that and get more gongs and get a gong away at it. So.
Well, like you, I like to practice too, and that's fun. And it's not hunting season all year round, but you can practice.
Right.
You can practice
exactly.
all year round. So.
Right. Yeah.
My philosophy is, if I'm out there practicing shooting, that hopes are going to make me a little bit better when hunting season comes
sure,
along.
Sure. Exactly.
So.
You betcha. So, the way I do those gongs now, if I'm going to shoot those with a rifle, the manufacturer says don't shoot them with a rifle unless they're 100 yards distant. They're naturally worried about, you know, bullets bouncing around the ricocheting. So.
So you have them like on a sawhorse so that you can move them to?
Yeah, I can just pick that horse up, carry it wherever I want to put it down. Yeah.
There you go.
Or back up. So, good deal. And then I got a pile of dirt back of it. So.
Very good.
Works good. Yeah.
Well, we've got some more deer stuff to see.
You betcha, lots of it. Let's do it. Okay.
So John, we've got a nice looking stand behind us here. So how'd you figure out where to put it?
Duane, this is probably one of my favorite stands here, and I'll tell you exactly why it's here. This is a natural geographic bottleneck. I call it a bottleneck. I've got big squares to the west, to the east, to the north, and everything funnels around this big ravine.
So that's too steep of a ravine that the deer aren't going to be walking on the sides of it. They've got to kind of walk
tough.
On the ridge here on the top for the
exactly.
most part.
Exactly. I do see them in there some, and I hear them falling too sometimes on the rocks, but they tend to want to run this little 40-yard bench right here. Then they'll go on south, cross the roads, and go into the other squares. But the last year I had a camera on this spot here for the first 2 weeks of rifle season. And I think I had something like 6 or 8 different legal bucks.
Wow.
Okay. Past this place. Again, I was done. I was in the house. I was staying out of it. But I had a nice buck with a bow last year. But the way it's looking this year, why, I may be hunting with a gun in there. So,
when you have rifle season different than archery, boom, boom, you know, all around, you know, all of us have been out there. You hear shots all different directions, and the deer hearing that too, and so that kind of throws them off their normal hiding and their normal patterns, right?
Exactly. They're scared. They're running, and they're just wanting to get out of where the shots are. And for some reason, they just seem to run this side hill. A lot of times, I see it and come in and go right down in that area there. I call the bull. And they'll bed down.
Kind of to hide there?
Yeah, and, they'll bed down, right. And I did shoot a big buck here one time, a big 9-point with a bow, chasing does in the rut. Be the last part of October, coming right through here. Again, just a natural funnel. I've got a camera down here that we'll check when we leave. I want to check that camera and pull a disc. And you'll see by the bank down here, it's pretty well tore up where they're funneling down and up that way.
Let me ask you about cameras for a second. I have one. A friend talked me out of going. He said, you're going to go there and check it all the time, and you're going to be, you know, making yourself too prevalent, you know, in front of where the deer are coming all the time. And so I didn't put it out this year at all. And you know, it sure is fun. You know, I can't stand it not going and checking the pictures,
right,
you know.
Right.
So he's probably right. I'm probably going there more often and maybe making the deer's patterns different. I don't know. What do you think about that?
I've got 6 cameras in this woods. In fact, I've got one more in the house to put out and make 7. But I check them at least once a week. I've got a little different theory on scent. I'm in this woods all summer. I'm brush hogging, I'm mowing, I'm cutting trees. And I'm a firm believer that the deer is kind of used to my scent.
Okay.
Last year I shot that big 8-point. I walked, as an example, I walked in that log road over there. An hour later, that big 8-point come in, walked the log road behind me, and I watched him. Smell where I was, and I thought, boy, I'm done. Picked his head up, he went right to the scrape, and I shot him. But I'm a believer that I'm in there so much, it's just like, oh, that's just him. Because they do seem to relax and just, but that's my theory. But I pull my discs about once a week.
I've seen advertised now new ones that you can get them sending pictures, sending text pictures to your cell phone and that sort of thing. And
right.
I haven't looked into that yet, but that would be interesting if you wouldn't have to go around and check it at all from you know, from a perspective of not putting your scent there or not you know, traveling around there scaring them away.
Sure. Right now the biggest drawback seems to be the price. You know, the price, you have to open a separate email account, I think. And the discs work and that's the way I do it.
One more time. So you got a cornfield over there, you got hiding area over there, you got a natural little sort of funnel spot here. Yep. It seems like this is the perfect spot.
It is. No doubt in my mind, if a guy stays here long enough, he's going to kill a nice buck. But again, I'm as selective as I am, I've only got 2 or 3 bucks that I'd shoot. Everything else I'm just going to let go by, and maybe a lot of times I have a camera that I put on my hat. It's kind of slick. You just reach up and hit the switch.
Touch a button, okay.
Yeah, like a GoPro when it films everything going on.
Okay.
Although sometimes during the excitement in a hunt, I have forgot to turn it on too.
Well, and I had the same thing happen to me this year, except the battery was dead. I went to turn the battery on when the deer came by, and it came on and went right off. Battery was dead. I shot the deer without the camera on.
Sure.
So I guess the folks will have to just believe me that's what happens. So
right.
That's my story anyway, so I don't know.
Yep. Oh, boy.
Well, I'm curious to see your camera down there. Let's go take a look at that.
Let's walk down there, and I've got it hid down there. And the way I have it set up, it's going to take a picture of the buck in the water. So he's got to get in the water to get his picture taken, and that makes for a nice picture.
Oh, very good.
Yeah. Okay, let's take a walk down over there.
So John, I see one of your cameras here. How'd you pick this spot? What's special about this spot?
This, for as long as I've been around here, this has been one of my best deer crossings. You know, you can see the trail over there.
Obviously real actively used there. You can see hoof prints in there like crazy. And now even with the leaves coming out, you can still see that that's very
busy. And the way the leaves are falling, why I know a lot of the bucks, the does, they run this. They're going out to the food plots and down in the lower bedding area. And so I put this camera here 2 or 3 days ago. I don't know how many pictures are on it, but I think I'll pull a disc and put it in my pocket. This is one of my newer cameras. This is a stealth cam. Seems to work pretty good. Just take a second here and we'll pop a disc out. Turn it off.
You got the memory card?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. I do this quite often with my cameras in the woods. I try to check them at least once a week. That way I know what's here, what bucks I have here. Sometimes I have bucks that I seem to get pictures of for three or four days in a row, then all of a sudden they disappear for weeks. But besides being a good crossing, why I think the water is going to make for some nice pictures when the deer are drinking or going through the water. So
now I notice I see the cameras advertised at the Sporting Goods ads that come in the mail, there'll be ones that could take the picture in so many tenths of a second, and you know, it has an infrared flash and all kind of, you know, any of those kind of things that you watch out for specifically?
Yeah, anymore they're doing away with the flash. This is infrared. Some of the cameras will have a little red glow at night. I think this one has a sort of a soft light. Doesn't seem to spook the deer, which is good. As far as settings, I like to put it on 10 seconds. Every 10 seconds, it'll take a picture.
So if that deer stands there, and he's there for a while, it'll take multiple pictures.
He's there. I want to get him good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I have it on 3 pictures. So when he comes through there, I'm probably going to get a picture on the bank. It's going to be a 1, 2, 3, and then he's gone. And if he comes back 10 minutes later, he gets it again. Okay. So, yeah, nice little cameras. And I've got some different kind up above here. I'll show you those cameras too. So,
very good. So John, I see the scrape that you mentioned before here. So it looks like that gets visited. There's leaves everywhere, and no leaves in that spot under those branches right there.
That's right.
So what's going on there?
That's one of our signposts. That's the scrape that the buck makes. And every buck in the area, just like a fire hydrant again, the bucks all come by, they urinate in the scrape. They always work the overhead limb with their preorbital glands on their eye. You can see a lot of the pine needles are off.
Rub some little bits of the branches off.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And even the does come in here night after night, work the scrape.
And so that's all basically like communication to each other. That,
exactly.
You know, I'm around here and the bucks are threatening the other bucks, leave me alone or stay out of my area. And
they all put their scent there, again, on the ground and the limb. And it's just sort of a dominance thing. Of course, when I find something like that, I always make sure I have a stand over.
Well, I see you got a good spot for a stand there. Was that about 12 yards away, something like that?
Yeah, probably 10, 12 yards. And again, they'll come through the creek crossing, which they do, and right to here. I've got an interesting story to tell you about this particular scrape. Several years ago, I had a ground blind, I think under that tree, I had a ground blind. And again, there was several big bucks here, and I had
this scrape comes each year, or
every year. That scrape guaranteed it'll be open, and usually it's.
You suppose it's because you got the low hanging branches there.
And, exactly right.
Okay. Okay.
But that year there was a piebald buck here. You familiar with the piebald?
Yeah, yeah, like half albino or partially. Yeah.
He was a beautiful buck. The year that I saw him here, he was a 5-point. He wasn't legal, but he came in one evening through these leaves. In fact, I've got pictures of him that the cameras here were taking his picture.
Okay.
Of course, I left him go. I watched him work the scrape. And again, I was in the ground blind there. And he just sort of fed out into the cornfield.
Uh-huh.
He wasn't legal that year. The following year, he was. But I had shot a bigger buck before that. So I and later why he was killed that year by across the road. But
now let me ask you a totally different question. There's a green rope hanging here to the side of your stand, safety-wise now. Sure. When you climb there with your archery equipment, you want to tie it on there and get up there, get yourself buckled in, and then bring things up so your hands aren't tied up carrying everything when you're going up.
Exactly. Right? I want both hands on those rungs. I get up there, of course, I tie my crossbow on. I get up, I get buckled in on my safety harness, and then I just pull the bow up. And that's the only way to do it when you're up in the air like that.
I know
that.
Myself, I feel more comfortable if I got three things touching. If one hand's reaching, okay, yep. Then I'll move a foot. Then yep. Another hand's reaching, then I'll move a foot. Right. I don't want to be letting go of two things at
exactly.
any one time.
And actually, they have made a new type of climber now, I don't know how it works, but you hook it on the ground, and it sort of keeps you from falling the whole way up, which actually I should actually go to that, but I haven't yet.
Well, still though, this system's gonna be a good way to go. You put the important gear on, you don't want that to fall out of your hand when you're climbing part way up.
Oh, right, sure. Whether it's my fanny pack or my grunt call, or, you know, I have everything right here close where I can get it. But this has always been a good stand. I've never shot a buck on it. I've passed a lot of nice bucks up here. Passed an 8-point up a few years ago that I wish later I'd have shot. He was about 16, 17 inches. He come up the trail and worked his scrape, and I left him walk, but good spot.
Well, thanks for sharing a secret spot here.
Yeah, very good spot, so.
Well, we got some more stuff to see. Let's take a walk.
Yeah.
So John, I see you got a camera here right across from the scrape that we looked at earlier. Now, something else that's interesting right here is right behind us, this tree's all scratched up here. Now, what's going on there?
As bucks often do, when they have a scrape that they use like every night, there'll be a buck rub close. That's sort of his territorial marker. Sort of like stay away, that's mine, or that kind of a thing.
So. I remember when I was young and I'd be walking in the woods, I'd see that, and I was assuming that was them just rubbing the velvet off their antlers, and that was like, it was itchy, so they were rubbing it off there.
Right, that's part of it, but it's a dominance thing. A lot of times, a buck will make thousands of rubs in a season, just himself. And it's a dominance thing, and makes their muscles strong. They fight, and that's...
So he's working his head
yeah.
and his neck and
exactly.
okay.
So one there and there's a rub over there right behind you there. It's you know, but that's
so
what
I get out a lot during small game season, and I'll see bigger trees, smaller trees, whatever. Do you think it's a, you know, if it's a bigger guy, he's taking on a bigger tree, or does that?
Yeah, pretty much. I've seen some really big bucks working really big trees, but I've seen some little bucks working big trees, and I've seen the okay. big bucks working small trees. So there you go. That there could be most anything. It's likely to be 16, 17 inch wide buck. That'd be my guess.
And can you tell by how far off the ground? It looks to me like that one goes from maybe about 3.5 feet down to about maybe 18 inches or whatever. The
right.
higher up a bigger buck, smaller,
yeah,
smaller
the
buck
higher,
lower down?
Yeah, it makes sense that the higher his rack or the bigger, higher he stands, the higher the rub's gonna be. Now I've been out west and seen the elk rubs and the mule deer rubs, and of course they're up, you know, head height. So
I see one little spot that's coming way up the trunk here.
Right.
That's going to be closer to 4 feet where that one is.
Right.
And that's in there pretty deep, so that must have been
yeah.
a pretty good.
Sure. So he's got, I would say that deer's got some pretty good tines on him, you know, probably the ones that I'm getting pictures of here, and they're 18, 20 inches. So that's probably one of them, I'm sure.
So I'd say most hunters recognize seeing that, but there's a lot that you can learn from that.
Right. You can learn a lot, you betcha.
Very interesting.
You want to hunt around scrapes, even in rifle season, scrapes are an excellent place to hunt. They're underestimated. You know, after the first couple days, the woods quiet down, that'd be an excellent spot to hunt.
There you go.
So, okay.
Up the road here a little ways is your food plot. I would
yes.
like to have
yeah.
you show some things up there.
We've got a couple more scrapes on the way, more cameras, and yep. Okay.
All right, John. So we're at one more of the scrapes here, and you mentioned before about some of the scent. So what's to do? Is there a magic trick here you gotta pull to keep them coming?
It's magic, Duane. What I'm gonna do is I call it agitating the buck. I've got several big bucks that I see on this scrape. And there's no doubt in my mind that I'll get a picture of this buck probably tonight on that camera again. He seems to come around every night, middle of the night. So he's going to see that the leaves are clear. You see I'm putting the leaves in one pile. That's the way a buck does. He just kind of kicks with his front legs and he makes a pile of
leaves. Pulls them back, draws them back.
So if he walks this road tonight, he's going to say, hey, what's going on? So I'm going to be here in this stand tomorrow morning.
Okay.
And my guess is I'll see his track in it. That's all the longer it takes. Now, I'm going to take this pad. All that is a felt pad that'll hold the scent. And I'm going to hang it on the overhead limb. He doesn't necessarily have to see it, but he will certainly smell it. Okay.
You see a little twist tie on there that you're using to hold it? Okay.
Yep. Now, doe urine. You could use straight doe urine or even doe and estrus urine would be good. And there's a good chance he may even pull this down. We'll soak it pretty good.
And it doesn't matter if some of that drips down on the ground?
No, because okay. That's where it's going next.
Okay.
A lot of times when you come upon a fresh scrape, especially in the morning, you'll see the urine in there from the buck and you'll see his print. So we're going to doctor this guy up pretty good. Use up some of this scent. But that's the way I will do now, and I'm interested to come back tomorrow morning and get in my archery stand and we'll see what's going on. And this is also great for rifle season.
Okay.
You don't necessarily need to put the pad on the scrape. You can put your pads anywhere in the woods, like the funnel I just showed you. That's an excellent place. You could have two or three of them in there. You could also use cotton balls if you don't have the pads.
Okay.
Any kind of cotton balls or an old rag. And they'll wind check them usually downwind, and when they smell it, they come in.
Interesting.
Works.
Now I'm seeing something pretty green over there. Can we take a look at that?
Hey, let's look it over. That's my food plot.
Okay. So we're in the food plot here, and I'm seeing clover and a clear break here from the clover to the next. But why the clover, and how's it worked?
Okay, well, what's going on here, Duane? This plot here in the center was last year's plot, and white clover, and this probably in June and July was probably close to knee high, but the deer have got it all eaten off.
And it's still coming back.
Yeah, it's still coming back.
We're filming in November here. It's still coming back. It looks nice and green and fresh.
Right. And they're hitting the center really hard, which is why I have the camera. Again, I have a camera on this. And I intentionally left this limb here for a reason this summer when I was trimming limbs. I said there will be a buck make a scrape on this. And okay. One day I come back and there's a scrape.
How about that? Okay.
Where the does eat is where the bucks leave their sign.
Okay.
This is one of two that me and a good buddy made last year, or this fall rather, September. And both this plot and the one on the end is sort of a conglomeration of a little bit of everything. The tall stuff is oats. As far as I know, it's oats. There's just a little bit of everything in here. And the deer hit it every night. I've got a lot of pictures here of does in daylight. Several shooter bucks here in the daylight, but I wasn't in the stand, I guess. So
I'm seeing goldenrod back there. So the bucks will hide in there. They'll lay down bed in that.
Yeah, a lot of the deer around here love to bed in goldenrod fields.
Okay.
And hunters have to keep that in mind, particularly in rifle season. Get out in and get in the goldenrod fields and get them jumped.
And, now, why is there a path down the middle of this one?
I do that for a reason. When I'm like in that stand or some of the stands down there, it does direct them to the food plot.
Okay.
And I can see them quite a ways off coming through that long goldenrod field. It's a funnel. We're back to the funnel word.
So if you got a funnel that's, you know, on the ridge on top of a ravine or whatever,
yeah.
you made a funnel,
yeah,
here.
You
made,
yeah, that. You can make your own funnel.
Okay.
That funnel could have been made. Last year I made it from that corner to that corner, and you could hang a stand there, and when they come out of it, because the deer don't, they like to bed in it, but they don't like to walk through it. So you make them a path and they'll follow it.
Okay.
So, but this plot's being used pretty good. I'm getting a lot of pictures here, so.
How about that?
Yeah.
So if you're gonna make a food plot, any particular, now here, what do we got here, quarter of an acre or something? Any,
yeah,
particular,
probably, yeah.
How big does it have to be, and where do you put it, and that kind of stuff?
Myself, I like them small. That, okay, way I can shoot them. I've got the stand down there.
So you could hit from the far corner to your stand?
Probably to this one and that one for sure. But most times when they come in, they seem to walk and eat. They're here, then they're in the clover,
okay,
then they're back down on the lower one. If they were hitting this one more, I'd be quick in moving the stand.
Maybe a stand over here closer to this,
yeah,
part of it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because if you have a huge big food plot, it's not much good if the deer is on the wrong end of it all.
100 yards away, it's not going to work,
exactly,
in archery season.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
So I prefer the small, and again, you can put stands all around them.
Now, I've seen advertisements, and oh, you got to buy our brand of seed, and you got to buy the other guy's,
right,
brand of seed. Anything, any magic to that to you, John?
I think they're all good. Whitetail Institute's real good. Again, what we used this year was I had several bags, my buddy had several bags, and we just say, let's throw them all together. So as you can see, they grew,
so you have,
well,
a variety of things come
yeah,
up.
Yeah, we
here.
Limed it. I rototilled it in August,
okay,
and we put a lot of lime in it, a lot of good fertilizer, so you can see how it looks. But this will continue to grow up into the winter, and they'll be digging this stuff up all winter and eating it.
So even whenever there's snow on the ground, they'll know that there's food here.
Yeah.
So they're,
yeah,
going to,
right.
So you're keeping them around for next year.
Sure.
For, you know,
yeah,
so.
I'm feeding them good, and that'll help the does, you know, have more fawns, plus the buck's bigger rack. So that's why we do it. It works.
Well, John, we appreciate the advice. I appreciate you showing around out here on your property and all the tips. I learned last time. I'm learning more this time. So
well, that's good. That's good.
So John, I think you're like me, you like building stuff, right? You build a nice bridge here to get across from one part of your property to the other part.
Exactly, like for the golf cart and the ATV, why it saves you getting in the water. Of course, for the big tractor, why I go in the water.
But it's got pretty good traction. You can get down and through.
Drive, okay. Yeah, but this is nice for the wife when we walk. We don't get our feet wet, so yeah.
So now over here, I see a little sign that says Frog Pond. What's that mean?
Frog Pond, well, that means there's always been a little pond here, a little indentation, and I see now all summer it was full of frogs.
Okay.
So I thought they'd put up a sign that says Frog Pond, but it's pretty back here in the fall with the leaves, and got a few crabs in there, and I think there's a few minnows, maybe a few fish in there, so kind of adds to the looks of the property, I think.
No, I got to ask you, is there a story about this this deer head here?
Yeah, kind of. I think every deer head has a story. I didn't shoot that one, but a good old buddy of mine gave that to me one time and told me to put it in a special place. So I thought, well, this is a special place. Put a couple screws in him and a couple of them turkey feathers, and here he is.
Well, John, I certainly appreciate the advice and the tips and the stories that you gave us here today, and I bet the viewers do it as well.
Well, I hope so. I hope I taught him something or
good.
Will help him, you know, toward getting a deer.
So. Going to see more columns and things from you in the future?
Yeah, I write not every week like I used to, but I write, I guess, when I have time, when I'm not building teepees or not back here trying to kill a buck, then I write when I'm caught up, yeah.
Well, John Crooks, thanks for being with us on Crawford County Outdoors.
Thanks for having me.
And thanks to the folks at home for joining us, and we'll talk to you next time.